My name's John Patton. I'm the host of TGC News here on The Gun Collective, and this is the story of my first ever hunt with a centerfire rifle. Let's get to it. A few months back, I got a phone call from my friends at Armisite asking me to go on a hunting trip that was one of the most epic I could possibly imagine. My first ever hunting trip with a centerfire rifle would be down in South Texas hunting for something called nilgai. It's the weirdest looking animal I've ever seen. I didn't know what the hell that was until I Googled it, so you should probably do the same. Think of a prehistoric horse. That's what a nilgai looks like. We needed rifles and ammo too, so I called my friends up at Falcor Defense to bring out the hammers. And then, of course, my friends at Underwood Ammo supplied a monstrous amount of this new 165 grain 300 Win Mag that we were actually testing and kind of developing while we were on this trip. I guess first you guys want to see the gun. This is pretty ridiculous. The rifle I'm using on my first ever centerfire hunt is a Falcor Defense Petra 300 Win Mag with a Silencer Co. Saker 7.62 on the end, and mounted on top was an Armisite Zeus Pro 100 for a total value of about $17,000. Ridiculous. I mean, most people will go out in the hunt with, you know, a slug gun or a lever action or maybe a bolt action, whatever it is, and I went out with a $17,000 package. Talk about being spoiled, right? My backup gun, the one I had on my chest that you'll see in a few of these shots, was my Agency G40 10mm long slide in a Gunfighters Inc. holster. It's a Kenai holster. It's really, really cool. Super comfortable. In fact, I'm going to be using that just about every time I go out hunting because it was so good. Underwood really came through with some prototype 300 Win Mag loads using a specially designed 165 grain Lehigh controlled chaos bullet. It was kind of a rush thing, but they hustled and came through like the champions that they are. I'm never let down by their ammo. You might have seen in the PA hunting trip video, my hog hunt over on full30.com, that I took a 250 pound pig with some other Underwood ammo with the 350 grain XP. And I mean, the consistency and the power that they deliver is fantastic. Seriously, I genuinely really like their ammo. Now, during this trip, we were constantly running around. It was super hot. Everybody is running on almost no sleep, you know, coming in from different parts of the country. We've got the Falcor guys in Montana, Armisite's out in California. I came down from PA, all the South Texas, way out of our comfort zone, and it was crazy. Everybody was exhausted. Nilgai are kind of elusive, and you kind of have to beat them at their own game. It's something you have to constantly be playing a game of chess with them. You know, it's that type of animal. They're also notoriously tough. Our guide told us a story of one taking 308 to the neck and walking it off, just leaving and walking it off. They said they could find animals all the time with multiple rounds in them from previous hunts and just, you know, it didn't take them down. So that's why we were using the Win Mag. After getting the rifle zeroed and kind of getting settled in, it was time to go get some meat on the table. My first night out was in an elevated blind with a guy named Brad Peacock. Brad is a longtime hunter and actually manages some of the biggest ranches in the United States. We got into the elevated blind at about 8 p.m. and started the long wait. And then we waited some more and some more. We didn't see a damn thing the first night out. You know, I had always heard these stories of how you kind of get to know people on a different level at hunting camp, and I'd never experienced that. And this was the first time I got a hint of that. Brad is a super knowledgeable guy and could tell I was a little bit nervous and anxious to really get one of these giants on the table. He was able to keep me calm and collected and my head in the game by, you know, telling me what to look for and, you know, what the animal is actually gonna look like in the thermal, because to this point, I had never seen one. Fast forward to the next day, a little bit of range time, a little bit of camaraderie, and some more education from Brad. This time when we went out, we went to a different area on another portion of the ranch in a ground blind this time, thinking they may be coming from a different area. I hadn't seen anything more than like whitetail and raccoons and rabbits through the thermals. When you're sitting out there just soaking in the surroundings, you start to get a different appreciation for the guys that hunt all the time. It takes discipline, and I don't have any video of it because it was pitch black at the time, but Brad and I got out of the blind at about 11 p.m. and hiked down a dirt road about a mile or two looking for these animals, trying to get a bead on them. And let me tell you, there is nothing like walking down a dirt road in rattlesnake country in complete darkness, wondering if you're gonna step on something that's gonna bite you and potentially kill you. It was a unique thing. I could tell all the guides there were actually starting to get a little bit anxious themselves. They really wanted me to get on one of these things and really get a lot of meat on the table. They know how much meat can come out of an animal like this, and they wanted to see it happen, especially with a new hunter. And when you get with a group of guys like this, everybody is on the same mission. Get a nice animal down and get people fed. But this was the night to end all nights. As Brad and I were driving back into camp, we found out that Clint from Falcor took down a huge axis deer. I mean, it was as big as he is. I mean, it was monstrous. Apparently, he and his guide actually stalked the thing for like 250 yards through thorn bushes and with wind changing. And of course, Clint is walking around with a Falcor Petra without a suppressor on it with a huge break. And we actually heard the shots from across the ranch. It was pretty cool. It was at this point that they asked me if I was ready to go back out there and take something down. And of course, you know I was. This time I went back out to the elevated blind that we started in early on the trip with a young man named Steven West. You might know him from a hunting show on the Sportsman's Channel called Southern Chaos. Steven is a Texas boy and he loves this. This is what he thrives on. We got into the blind at about 1 a.m. 1 a.m. in the morning when everybody's sleeping, I was out there hunting. Pretty cool. And it was dark. I mean, really, really dark. I mean, there was no hope of filming this. And that's kind of the downfall of night hunts. I don't have a night vision camera, so we couldn't show anything that happened at night. You know, we got settled in the blind and just started scanning all the windows back and forth, looking for a monster nilgai. We heard shots off in the distance at about 3 a.m. And Jason Sanju, one of the owners of Falcor, took down a really, really nice female nilgai. And when things like that happen in an adjacent area, you immediately start looking for animals coming towards you. That's bound to happen, you know, a shot goes off and they hear it, the animals start to move. So we were eagerly waiting for something to get flushed in our direction. It wasn't but like 10 minutes later, a few sizable, big nilgai. I mean, it's hard to describe. They're, you know, 400 plus pound animals. They come walking into our view. Steven lets me know, that's the one, buddy. Take that one. My heart starts pumping. You know, this is the moment. This is what I've been down here for. I've been waiting for a few days. This is it, right? This is coming. Besides a bull that I missed about an hour earlier at about 500 yards, this was my first real chance at taking down a nilgai. And this was it. Steven called it out, dude, that's a really good one. Hold right above her back and take it. You know, obviously the whisper talking that happens like on hunting shows, like, dude, take her. You know, it's kind of surreal. So I'm out the front window of the blind just leaning on this gigantic rifle in these windows that were, I mean, barely bigger than a mailbox. I'm leaning on this big rifle. I let out a breath and start sending rounds. Psh, psh, you know, going through the suppressor. It was, I mean, I can't really describe it. Just bang, 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 chasing this animal. I pull the rifle in as she's running. She's about 300 yards out, just starts running. So I pull the gun in as I'm shooting, you know, multiple rounds, pull the gun in, go, I'm coming in, out the side window of the blind, leaning on my guide, leaning on Steven, you know, to try and stabilize this gigantic rifle in this small blind that it's not meant for. And psh, and she just, bang, she just tumbled. So that's it, right? No, that's not it. What happens? We started to try and track this thing. Because it was so far out, it was pitch black. Even with the thermals, we couldn't find anything. We're scanning with flashlights, we're out there with night vision, thermals just going back and forth. The other guys came out with a truck, still couldn't find it. And this is at 3 a.m., guys. It's super late. Everybody's super tired. We decided to come back out a few hours later when it was light out and really try and track it down. Brad actually brought his dog out, and as it turned, it was actually farther away. Originally, we had thought it was like a 250-yard shot or so, but it was like 300 plus. I never did get the exact distance from the blind. You know, it was in tall brush, and I was actually the one who found the thing. I'm walking around, you know, everybody's looking in a certain area, and I'm like, you know what, I'm gonna check a little bit farther out. And then there she is in the grass, the first nilgai that I ever took down at 300 plus yards, who knows? And it was just incredible. There's no feeling like coming across a harvest that you took. So you can actually see the blind in this video. That little itty bitty dot, yeah, that's the blind. That's where I shot that animal from. So let's kind of recap here. I took down a 400 pound animal at 3 a.m. from 300-ish yards away at a full run with a 300 Win Mag semi-auto that had a $10,000 thermal optic on it using custom ammunition, all made by my friends. I used that stuff to take down my first ever centerfire rifle kill. My first ever hunt was with stuff from people that I respect and that I care about, and it happened at the ripe old age of 32 years old. It's not a story everybody can tell. It's really not. It's really unique, and I'm extremely fortunate that things like that are opportunities that I'm presented with. I got to meet some of the coolest people in the world on this trip. This is where my life has brought me. These are the opportunities that I've earned through what I do, and that's very special to me. Now, the gear, let's break that down. Since I know you guys are probably wondering what I thought of all that stuff after using it for a few days. Well, let's start with the animal. I hit her once in the neck and once clean through the lungs. The ammo did exactly what I needed it to do. And now keep in mind, that was a round that's in development with Underwood, Lehigh, and Falkor. You know, the bullet, the actual load, and then Falkor doing some testing and really dialing it in for the rifle. It's kind of a collaborative thing. And it was pretty cool to get out there and test some of the early versions of that. So the rifle, I mean, it's a 300 Win Mag semi-auto. I mean, there's almost nothing else like it, and both of the 300 Win Mag semi-autos out there that are worth even mentioning were both designed and kind of headed up by Clint Walker himself, who was on the trip with me. So I used the newer version that he is very, very proud of, and the recoil impulse is almost nothing. I mean, you guys have heard about this rifle, and it was awesome. It's not really what I would call lightweight by any means. I mean, it's not like super heavy. It's not a Barrett, but it's not like a 4-pound AR-15. It's just not that. And of course, the optic. What did I think of the $10,000 thermal optic mounted to my rifle the whole time? Once I got the hang of dialing in the focus, which, by the way, can we get camera companies to use that focus ring? That thing was really, really good. Once I got the hang of that and like zooming in and zooming out, really just using the optic. Once I got the hang of it, I was kind of right at home with it. I was able to see some incredible detail at long range, close range, whatever. It wasn't like I could only use it in a certain distance. You know, I'm not like an operator with tons of thermal experience or anything like that. I'm still very, very new to that technology. And as far as I can tell, that's exactly what I would want out of a $10,000 optic. It would have to be that good. I wish I could show you guys everything from the trip, but we'd be here for hours. The fact of the matter is, I had an incredible time. I got to use some incredible gear and hang out with some awesome people. Special thanks again to my friends at Armasite for bringing me out there and allowing me to do this. And of course, Falkor and Underwood for kind of bringing it all together. Guys, if you enjoyed this video, it's a little bit different than what you normally see here on the Gun Collective. If you want to see more, hit that like button. If you didn't, let me know down in the comments so we can talk about it. Of course, share it with your friends if you're into this sort of thing. And as always, thank you all for watching. We'll see you soon.